Welcome to a conversation with Terry Lundgren. Terry was recently named executive chairman at Macy's after a highly successful more than 13-year career as the CEO and chairman of Macy's, and many years before that in predecessor companies, including Federated Department Stores. Welcome, Terry. We're pleased to have you with us today. Why don't we getting started? What happened? How did you decide to become a participant in the retail industry?
Well, it actually goes back to this business school's name on the wall here, because I was a senior at the University of Arizona in Tucson, and I was basically interviewing with anyone who would talk to me. And Bullock's Department Store came, which was Federated at that point, came to talk to me. I had an interview on campus. It went very well. They sent me to Los Angeles for a second interview. I said no to the HR department, human resources department, and they said, "What do you mean? You got to come work for us." And they said, "Wait right here." They took me upstairs. They introduced me to a guy. I'm 21 years old. They take me upstairs and meet a guy named Alan Questrom.
Is that right?
That's right. And he was the senior vice president and general merchandise manager of home furnishings for Bullock's department stores. And you know, as you know, that took about 30 minutes of a conversation. I said, "Where do I sign?"
So he made the sale, obviously.
He closed the deal. I'd already said no to the fantastic college recruiter, and Alan sort of turned the tide for me.
And was Alan a mentor then? Did he become a fast mentor throughout your career, would you say?
Yes, very much so. He and a guy named Mike Steinberg, who worked for Alan. I was a lowly trainee, but Alan was the senior vice president. Mike was the vice president. And the two of them just took me in, and I came to work 6 months later after I graduated, and they both took me in and kept an eye on me. And I really owe them both a lot for just giving me the chance to shine. The work was up to me. But knowing that I had these eyes upon me was encouraging.
They clearly knew they were onto something here in engaging and mentoring you. What do you think it was? You know, our students often think about, well, how am I going to get people to pay attention to me in leadership in my early on assignments?
Yeah, I think I try to do the same thing, but I don't try to pick them out myself. Just like Alan didn't pick me, the human resources college recruiter did. Mm-hmm. And he said, "Alan, I'd like you to meet this guy because I'm about to lose him and to Xerox." And so, so I do the same thing. I have my human resources team evaluate the highest potential young people in our company. I do a breakfast club once a month, which is 14 because there's 14 seats around a table next to my office, and have breakfast with them for an hour. But they're selected by the HR department. All I do is try to have a conversation and hopefully make a good impression.
Now, you mentioned Alan as having been a mentor. What did you learn from Alan along the way?
I learned, a lot. We worked together for a long time, 13 years, in fact, from the time I was a trainee to the time I became the president of Bullock's Wilshire. Alan, first of all, he was a great negotiator. You may have found that.
I've discovered that, yes.
He was a great negotiator, and so he would listen very closely to what would work for the other person on the other side of the bargaining table and make sure he was including that person's wishes into the overall package. So that was first. Always, it's not just one-sided. It's got to work for both parties, one. Two is, he recognized people all the time. Wherever he had a chance, he would always point out, "You did a great job, Sally. Nice, I remember what you did for me in this particular subject matter or this particular, product category you bought." He always would go out of his way to recognize people. And then I think really important was he focused on the customer. What would the customer say? What would the customer think about this decision? And I'm outside of my office. It's my title hasn't, I don't put chairman of the board or chief executive officer. It says chief customer officer. Has that been outside my door for years. And I really try to do that. And I think Alan really gave me those roots to think like a customer.
Mm-hmm. Now, at Macy's, during your tenure, you've been recognized as a true leader in transforming retail from so many things you've done within the Macy's family. The localization of purchasing of merchandise to be catering to local tastes, early entrant in e-commerce, and much more. How do those kinds of ideas come to you? Are they 2 a.m. moments, or is it truly the listening to the customer or anticipating? How does one develop the muscles to be able to to come to those conclusions?
Well, I think, first of all, Ken, that you know, when your back is against the wall, you'd be amazed at how creative you can be. And you know, there's been a number of times in my career, you know, looking at back, it's like 2001, of course, was after 9/11. You know, customers just simply stopped shopping, and I had to think fast. You know, what were we going to do to get consumers back in our stores? 2008 financial crises, you know, really looked bleak for department stores. Yes. And for our industry. What big changes can we make to reinvent ourselves and take costs out of our structure and become more local and locally relevant? And so there's all these big moments that pushed us, I think, that really created the innovation. And I think that we're in one of those times now. And so as challenging as business is for mall-based department stores and specialty stores is, I think it's going to be a time when innovation is going to just burst, and you're going to see a lot of new ideas in response to the need to bring customers back in. So to me, it's all about desperation, you know, to drive innovation.
So perspiration creates inspiration.
Exactly.
Very interesting. So here we sit. We've got online retailers growing by leaps and bounds, more traditional venues feeling more pressure. How do you see the department store world? How do you see bricks and mortar retailers in general being able to counter or complement the digital, the online commerce aspects that are growing so rapidly?
Well, as you said earlier, we were among the first to be aggressive about creating this powerful, not just online business, but omni-channel business. Yes. So we recognized that the consumer was in charge, and they were going to decide how they were going to shop. And we knew that if we didn't have a powerful online business, they would just go somewhere else. And so people said, well, aren't you worried about cannibalizing your own business? Back then, the answer was no, because if they weren't going to shop with us because we didn't have a big online business, that means they're going to shop someone else with an online business, not just come into our store. But now, that worked fantastically well from 9, 10, 11, 12 through 2014, where we grew, you know, for 5 years straight on an average of $1 billion a year of incremental sales without new stores, 38 less new stores than at the beginning. But, you know, now that business is no longer incremental. So we're the sixth largest internet company in America. We're the third largest in our categories of apparel, accessories, and the like. But it's no longer incremental. Now the store business is deteriorating while the online business is growing. And so we have to figure out that next idea to make the stores a much more friendly environment to execute a transaction there while keeping the momentum of our online business. So to me, frankly, long term, all retailers are going to have physical presence.
They are.
All of them are going to have that. Amazon included.
And they're doing it.
And they're doing it. They're beginning it now. But I really believe that, you know, the way consumers are buying products in our categories are still that they come into the store, they start with their phone, they research where they're going to go, they come into our stores, they actually try the product on, or they sit on the bed that they're going to buy, or they touch the towel they're going to buy, and are trying the clothes, and then they make their decision. Now, they may make their decision again on their phone to buy it elsewhere. If somebody else will ship it to them for a lower price, why not? Yeah. You know, but that's where we all have to change. And retailers have to become more precise on dynamic pricing, because today you can search and fish and find a better price somewhere on a same item. So there's lots of work going on this subject, but I think the ultimate winner will be the combination of brick and mortar and a strong online business.
So the emerging convergence, you see a convergent model where online as well as physical space plus the mobile, it's really an ecosystem as opposed to one or the other, or a dynamic where one dominates the other.
Precisely. And I think today the challenge is that there's just simply too much space devoted to retail in America. And this is a statistical fact, okay? So America has three times the amount of square footage per human being that they have in the second most populated space-wise country in the world, which is Australia and UK and Canada, okay? So we consume a lot more in America, so we should have more retail space, not three times.
So there'll be fewer.
Going to be a rationalization, and you've seen this with many retailers now closing stores I think we actually started this trend 2 years ago when we said we were going to close 40 stores. We closed 100 last year, announced 100 last year. So now you've seen Penny's are closing 140. Sears are closing many. You're seeing Limited closing all their stores. So the rationalization of retail space must occur over the next few years. And then the supply and demand comes back in line once again. And I think that omnichannel system works.
And do you see this convergence? Do you see a scenario where the branding efforts, what are the implications for how one brands Macy's, as an example?
Oh, I think that's critical, because people are going to end up shopping where they trust, you know, the history of that company and the experience that they've had with that company. So I do think it's going to take a lot of capital and marketing and messaging and, frankly, delivering and executing on the customer's wishes, our promise, our brand promise, in order to win customers in the future.
So with 159 years under the belt of Macy's, and I marvel over the fact that the first day of R.H. Macy's existing in New York, I believe the revenues were $11.06,
right.
Which is just amazing as you think to fast forward 158 years. The role of Macy's being prominent in the community, which is something you've been a very strong advocate for in terms of philanthropy, in terms of volunteerism, in terms of corporate social responsibility and sourcing, diversity and inclusion initiatives. This is part and parcel of who and what Macy's is.
No question.
The relevance, I sense, is not going to diminish. It's going to perhaps even become more important. I mean, who else has a Thanksgiving Day parade that's watched by millions
That'd be
the
no
world?
One. Okay, so we've got certain things. Right now, by the way, the flower show is going on right now. So we've got these amazing, iconic events. But to your point, you know, the department store industry has been a piece of the fabric of communities for decades, and that's why it's important. It's very important that we figure this out again, you know, to not just survive but to thrive, because the communities count on us, and it's not just to employ their citizens or for a local place to shop, but how we give back, you know, because our employees end up spending in that community. Number one, we have 140,000 employees, and that's, we're just one retailer, but retail is the largest employer outside of the government in the United States. And so this is a really important subject for all of us to recognize, a community relationship. But we also give back. Last year we gave back, between us and our customers, our employees, $60 million back to the communities that we serve and who serve us by being a customer of ours. And so this is a really critical part of America and what makes us very relevant in these local communities. And so that's it's a key point that gets missed sometimes.
Sometimes. And not every company engages in this way with their communities to their detriment over time. Now, you've recently made a significant transition. You've become executive chairman. You handed the reins over to your successor. It's hard to make these transitions typically. What advice would you have for folks as they think in the future about someday they're going to be making transitions as well?
Well, I think, first of all, this is something you don't do overnight. This is something that's a planned, thoughtful, organized event that takes place over years. And when we consolidated the company after 08 and 09 into New York from 7 operating divisions, then I was picking my all-star team to bring the team to New York, and I knew then that I had only been the CEO at that point in time for 5 or 6 years, that then one of these individuals would likely be candidates among that group to be my successor over time. And so that was a start. And then 2 years ago, I named my board of directors and myself named Jeff Gannett to become the president, and that was a clear signal internally and externally that he would be the next Terry Lundgren, and I couldn't be more proud that day has just occurred. So
what's next for Terry Lundgren then in this circumstance?
You know, you'd be amazed. I'm amazed at how many things have come my way. there's been a lot of very interesting things. Frankly, some very interesting things in academia, which I have said I'm not qualified for. Frankly, some really really interesting jobs. My kids have told me I'm not qualified for that, but there are.
Kids told me that too. So please don't
yeah,
don't worry.
You've already risen above that cloud and proven success. So very interesting, but also, you know, private equity, venture capitalists.
Yes.
There's been a number of people who have offered me for very interesting things. And what I've said is, thank you very much. I'm on the board of Procter & Gamble. I'm on the Federal Reserve Bank board. I'm going to do a number of things now. I'm chairman of the Economic Club of New York. So I said, listen, I got a job to do right now. I'm going to help make Jeff Gennett and Macy successful and get us on the right track. Mm-hmm. That's my first and foremost. And then I have direct responsibilities for all the real estate activities and international and the like. So I'm busy for the moment. But over time, there's lots of things that I'm excited about exploring.
Yeah. Now Terry, you like Alan, have been wonderfully philanthropic with your alma mater, University of Arizona, the center, the Terry J. Lundgren Center for Retailing. Is it in the water that you drink at Federated and now Macy's that says you should endow an important part of education? Or how did this come about for you at University of Arizona?
Well, for me, and I think for Alan, I came from humble beginnings, and my parents did not go to college. I have four sisters and a brother. None of them graduated from college. So I just look back and how lucky I was. I was just surrounded by friends that were going to college. I played basketball and thought I could be a, you know, college star in basketball. By the way, my team just lost in the Sweet 16, yeah, University of Arizona. But, but, you know, I look back how lucky I was, you know, to have the experiences that I have had, and I'm just so grateful for that. I never, ever forget that. And so I want to give back because I really grew up in college, and the University of Arizona meant a lot to me. And, you know, my father cut me off when I was a sophomore, and I had to work my way through college my junior and senior year. And all of those experiences are what I think made me, you know, as successful as I'm lucky as I've been, but it's really a luck had a lot to do with it. And so I want to give back and give other kids the opportunity to find the success that I've been able to find.
Well, that's so wonderful and so important in today's day and age. Now, your leadership style evolved over a period of time. Alan was influential, as were others. How would others describe your approach to leadership?
You know, I think my team would say that I'm a good selector of people, and you know, the first thing that both Alan and I would agree on is that it's not just us ever. It's always about the team that we surround ourselves with, and if we can pick, you know, and groom and reinforce, nurture, and you know, mentor the team around us, each as individuals running their part of the business, we're going to be successful. And so that's first, the team. And then I think that team, in my case, would say that I listen. I'm very curious. I asked 1,000 questions, sometimes too many and sometimes late at night. But I ask a lot of questions because I'm really curious to know. And at the end of the day, when I'll make the decision. I'm happy to make the decision. And so not everybody's going to agree. But we walk out, I believe, arm in arm and saying, this is our decision because we've hashed it out. We've worked it through. And this is our decision. And here we go. Yeah. And I think that's the only way you're going to get great execution is when everybody has that same sense of belief that we're together on this. But they only do that if you asked their opinion. Mm-hmm. And I listen pretty closely to all of those great ideas.
So you're really seeking that buy-in. The input really yields buy-in, even if
Correct.
It's not taking the course that they might suggest to you as
Correct.
An employee.
Well
now,
said.
Most difficult decision you've made as an executive in your career?
Oh, the hardest for sure is when you have to make the decision to downsize and eliminate jobs. And it's happened to me a couple of times in my tenure. And there's nothing more gut-wrenching when you have to make a decision that's going to benefit the rest of the 100,000+ employees by taking away the jobs of several thousand. You know, that's the hardest
part.
You know, and you know, I take responsibility for them. They count on me and our company for their income, and so when I have to take that opportunity away, hopefully it's temporary, and they'll find something even better, you know, down the road. But that's the hardest thing
hardest
for sure.
Part. And helping them to land potentially
sure.
is so important. The biggest risk you've taken as a CEO.
Well, you know, people would say that the biggest risk I took was to change the name of 400 department stores in one day to the Macy's brand. Mm-hmm. That included brands like Meyer and Frank and Marshall Fields and, you know, Foley's in Texas, all of these great brand names. And that was a risk, certainly. But I think the bigger risk was when I consolidated all of the divisions into New York. I had buying offices in LA and San Francisco, in Seattle, in Atlanta, in Miami, different places. And that bit was a very big deal because we were a very decentralized industry. So we had, you know, and then we acquired the May Company in 2005. We were, you know, kind of doubled down. Yes. And so that was a big decision too. But when we did that, I mean, between ourselves and May Company, we had 13 different operating companies trying to manage all of that. And yet we sold similar merchandise, you know. So, you know, different by location and different by market, and this color for that city and this weight of fabric for that one and the likes. But so I said, how do we get the efficiencies out of a central organization, but maintain and frankly improve upon the localization requirements in those markets? And that's what we did. And so those are big, big risks, all of them, but you know, worked out.
It worked out extremely well, didn't it? Now, leadership courage is a very important topic these days. And there are some who say leaders are born, not made. Others say leaders are made, not born. You've taken so many risks, and so many have turned out to bear fruit. Where did the courage come from?
I don't even know exactly where it begins. I just think that it just, you know, it's sort of like, you know, you play basketball, you know, I want the ball. You know, if there's okay. 3 seconds left to play, I want the ball, you know, and because I'm confident that I can make it. I may not be the best player on the team, but give me the ball because I'm going to be so focused on right. that and the need to make that last shot. And so I just feel like that's sort of a natural and instinctive part of me you know, I kept getting called to be a leader. Yeah. Even in my nonprofit, every nonprofit organization I've joined, I've been the chairman.
Yeah.
And I didn't plan on it. I didn't ask for it. I never asked for it.
Yeah,
it just sort of happened. Hey, Terry, how about you?
How about you? Yeah, what are you doing in your spare time?
Exactly.
So is it possible with employees to help them learn how to be courageous? They can certainly watch you as a role model as the CEO. Is there more that can be done to help employees become,
you know,
more courageous?
I think people will evolve, but I think role models are key. I think role models and I think mentorship is key. Mm-hmm. And Alan mentored me. Mm-hmm. He was very helpful to me. He gave me enough examples of when I was making a mistake that he wasn't criticizing me for it. He would simply talk to me about how I could have done it better. And I've tried to do the same with my own employees. I think if you create an environment that mistakes are okay, that you're likely to get more innovation in the future. As I think Alan said to me once, but if you make like 4 or 5 mistakes in a row, well then, you know, you need
to
go.
Or make the same mistake more than once.
Exactly.
A big problem.
Right.
Now, failures, we all have them as leaders. We don't look for them, but they sometimes find
sure.
us. Is there a failure you might share with us along the way where you made a decision, it didn't quite pan out the way you might have liked it to pan out, and what you might have learned from it?
Well, listen, there's, of course, I've made a number of decisions that didn't pan out, but I would say the most important one is that if I've, and I don't want to give a, I can, it's coming in my head right now, but I'm not going to reveal
sure.
the situation, that when you have a sense that an individual is not treating people just the right way, but they're a really good producer, you know, they deliver results, those are really hard to do. But I know I've waited too long on a couple of those examples, and when I did finally part ways with a couple of individuals that are in my head at the moment. In both cases, I had people say, "What took you so long, Terry?
Why did you wait so long?" Yeah.
And I'm like, "Well, you guys didn't tell me
that.
You know,
but
the results were good. But you know, shame on me, and shame on all of us bosses. You know, because you know, when you have a large number of employees, sometimes they're not. It's not filtering all the way up to you. And I think that's what's really helped me want to dive deeper into the organization. All of my store visits that I do are unannounced. I don't call them up and say I'll be there in a week. I call up and say I'll be there in 5 minutes, and I show up in a branch store in Oregon, you know, in a branch store in San Francisco, and they're, you know, they're a bit shocked, but I get facts. You know, there's no preparation. I see the store like the customer sees the store, no prep, and when I get answers that are spontaneous as opposed to prepared
rehearsed.
And so, you know, this kind of that's a management style that I've developed because of the example that you just
certainly being accessible, doing your very best to remove the barriers to pleasing the boss and making sure that you have the opportunity to be informed, and those courageous decisions are where you know that an employee is not living to the values of the enterprise, and it's important to make an adjustment. So when you make these surprise visits to the stores, What are you looking for?
Well, the first thing I'm looking for is how people are responding to the boss. Number one, and you can see it. And number two is
they know the boss.
Do they know the boss? Yeah, in a big store. And number two is is the store itself. Would I want to shop there? Does it look? Is it clean? Is it organized? Are people taking the initiative to pick up garments that have been tried on or dropped? Are the associates greeting customers? Is there a connection and an energy in the store that just feels positive? And you know what? I've been doing this for a long enough period. I can sum that up in a relatively short period of time walking through
a store. A couple of minutes and you're ready.
Yeah. And I do have the numbers because I'm prepared. I do have the numbers of the store before I go and how they're performing. But I don't need them. I can tell. I can generally tell whether the store is doing well or not. Yeah.
Now Macy's went through a number of years without being acquisitive. After you made the big change and became M on the New York Stock Exchange, Macy's Incorporated. More recently, you acquired Blue Mercury.
Yes.
Very interesting acquisition. Why and how do you see it fitting into the overall?
Well, the beauty space is such an important category for us. We are a huge seller of beauty products, and we're the largest seller of prestige fragrance in America. And so, it's a sort of a battleground that we wanted to make sure that we were able to satisfy customers in all places. In the case of Blue Mercury, it was an upscale, freestanding specialty store business with high-end brands that, frankly, were not accessible to Macy's in many cases, because the brands would like to have their counter, if you will, with a couple hundred square feet. And if you look at a store, outside of New York or outside of Boston, where they don't have enough volume to be able to manage that on an annual basis, that's just not going to work. The model doesn't work. But Blue Mercury was an open cell concept with lots of brands and associates that would roam and cover all these different brands. And then they had a very high level of service that included a spa where they actually would apply the treatments behind the scenes in a day bed. And this was a level of service that was very unique and above the level of typical department stores would present. So I thought this was a way to expand our reach to that consumer, but in the beauty business. And that business is doing great, and we're funding it. They're opening more stores than they ever imagined because we obviously have the funding to support them. But we also are bringing Blue Mercury inside of our stores and creating another higher level of service and excellence of high-end brands that the Macy's customers did not have exposure to in the past. So I love that combination.
In a way, it's a vertical integration in a way.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, indeed.
So now Bloomingdale's, very important part of the family as well. Do you see Bloomingdale's facing similar challenges, or are there different challenges for Bloomingdale's than Macy's?
Sure. Well, Bloomingdale's is a higher end, so the average ticket is basically twice what it is at Macy's. And so it's certainly got a customer that is, first of all, the big international tourist business there, and of course with the dollar as strong as it makes it difficult for international tourists to spend their money in the United States. That's been going on for a couple of years now, but just getting more so. And then there's just not that many pockets of wealth around the United States. We have 37 Bloomingdale's, and there's just not that many pockets of wealth around the United States that can support a regular diet of a Bloomingdale's or a Neiman's or a Saks Fifth Avenue. So it's hard to expand the locations there. But we're thinking about different ways about how we can do a smaller version get into more of these markets for them. I'm going to the Middle East this weekend. We have a store, a great store in Dubai, but we just opened our second store in Kuwait, a Bloomingdale's store there, and then we'll be opening in Abu Dhabi, a Macy's and a Bloomingdale's next year. And so I'll be able to inspect all of those locations. But I think there's some international potential for Bloomingdale's to expand.
Interesting. Now, ethical dilemmas. We face ethical dilemmas more often than not in our jobs, more frequently than we would hope for. Is there an ethical dilemma you might be willing to share with us that you might have encountered along the way, and how you addressed it, what you might have learned from it? Of course, you'd expect us to be really striving to help our students become informed leaders, exercising ethical judgment over time.
Sure. The hard ones are that happen to us is when products are produced in foreign countries And we're sort of guilty by association. Mm-hmm. So there might be a company that is producing product and they're under being scrutinized and they're getting some negative press about a certain way they're doing things. We may have nothing to do with the factory or the country where they're producing, but the fact that we buy from that company in other countries, in other places, we're guilty by association. Yeah. Those are hard. So because you want to support, you want to support these organizations that have called foul on the company, yet we're not participating in it. But they're encouraging us to put pressure on the company, worldwide.
Yes.
And so those are complicated, decisions for us because the group that's making product for us is perfectly ethical and doing all the right things and creating good product, but their sister company who's trying to clean up their act in other countries is not. So those are difficult and
very
challenging.
Difficult. So you have to go back to the values of the enterprise,
I suppose. Because if I pull out of that company, I'm going to hurt them.
Yes.
I'm going to really hurt them. Mm-hmm. Do they deserve to be hurt because this is a group of people in a completely different country? Do I deserve, am I responsible for those jobs that I'm about to pull away from? Because I can find somebody else to make the product. But now I'm gonna eliminate those jobs of people who are working hard every single day in a completely different company, in a completely different arm. Complicated.
Yeah. Very complicated. Final question, Terry. For our students who are about to embark on the world and their professional and personal lives, what final words of advice might you have for the next generation of leaders?
What I've said to my own employees and our students, there's a number of things that I've got Lundgrenisms here, but one of them that's been attached to me is bloom where you're planted. And it was a lesson that I learned from that same college recruiter that I turned down initially after 6 months on the job. I said, "Gee, I think I could be doing more, And so, he said to me, "Bloom where you're planted." And his message was, "Do that job that you think is easy for you, and you've got this down. Do that job better than you've ever done it before, but better than anybody's ever done it before, and people will notice. Do that because someday you might supervise that job, and one, and two is they will notice you and recognize you and give you a chance to do something else. Then do that job better than anyone has ever done it before." And I never forgot about that, and from that point, I stopped looking at what I could be doing next and focused on what I was doing now, and I didn't have to ask to be promoted again.
Such important words of wisdom. We've been in touch here in conversation with Terry Lundgren, Executive Chairman of Macy's Incorporated. Thank you for joining us, and thank you, Terry, for an inspirational conversation.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dean Freeman.